Erectile dysfunction due to venous leakage is somewhat of a mystery to me, especially when it concerns young men. Let me explain. In general, we have two types of blood vessels, arteries and veins. They also have somewhat different constructions. Arteries bring oxygenated blood into the target area, while veins take the used blood back to the heart, where it is pumped into the lungs for new oxygen. The same process occurs in the penis. For erections to happen, blood enters the penis via arteries and is kept there due to veins closing. In veno-occlusive erectile dysfunction, this does not happen. The veins stay open, resulting in erectile problems. My name is Stefan Buntrock and I'm a board-certified urologist and sexologist. A few weeks ago, I attended the annual meeting of the International Society for Medical Shockwave Treatment in Amsterdam. I had the chance to do an interview with Professor Irwin Goldstein, one of the world's most renowned experts in sexual medicine. In this interview, we also discussed the venous leak. I will show it to you in a second. But before that, you need to know about one important anatomical structure. The tunica albuginea is like a sock that covers the cavernous bodies of the penis. When intracavernosal pressure rises, it presses the veins against the tunica albuginea, closing them off because of the pressure. Venous leakage occurs if the pressure inside the cavernous bodies does not rise sufficiently. In the literature, there's a lot of talk about abnormal anatomical distribution of veins in the penis, especially concerning veno-occlusive erectile dysfunction in young men. I must say, I lack the necessary imagination to understand that, because if this were true, surgical treatment on penile veins would be effective long-term. In most cases, it is not. Results of venous surgery are usually good for a couple of months, then everything is back to square one. Veno-occlusive dysfunction is difficult to diagnose in young men and is difficult to treat. In Amsterdam, Professor Goldstein presented research showing that shock waves can restore cavernous smooth muscle to counteract veno-occlusive erectile dysfunction. So, here is what he told me.
Erectile dysfunction in the young male who is diagnosed with a venous leak. What is this? I have no idea what this is. Why should they have venous leakage?
Well, that's a great question. So it's a man's individual assessment. I don't think we can grossly say there's one reason for this. But we classically see venous leakage occur. You didn't, right behind me, it's an article.
Yeah, but
a presentation here that talks of that venous leakage is essentially excess fibrosis of the erectile tissue. So the question is not do they have venous leak, it is why do they have excess fibrosis of the corpus cavernosum tissue? Typically, you could argue it's around 50% muscle, 50% connective tissue. And we've done a lot of biopsying of penis and measuring with computers called Image J, the percentage of the tissue that is blue, that's connective tissue, and the percentage that is red. I don't know if you can see any
I can see it.
That information there, but when you say patients have venous leakage of any age, young people in particular, they have excessive fibrosis. So I can give you some of the reasons that we have understood. There's a condition called PSSD, which is an awful condition in and of itself, but there are individuals who are in families who love them, who want to help them, but they have anxiety in going to school, or they have hyperactivity or depression or whatever, and they're given an SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, at age 6, 7, 8, 9. I mean, before puberty has even started, before they can even make a decision whether they wanted to take this medicine or not. So we've identified that SSRIs can, in animal settings, increase the amount of what's called an oxygen radical. So oxygen is normally O2, and it's equally balanced molecularly, but you can get O3 minus, and that's an oxygen radical, and that attaches to the muscle and causes apoptosis or cell death, and a dead muscle cell turns into a scar cell, and a scar cell is what causes the venous leakage. So that's PSSD. We see another awful pharmacologic agent is for hair loss. And I won't comment on your hair, but there are people for whom even the thought of losing hair is particularly complicated. They have parents or cousins with balding, and that's not for them. So there's a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor.
Finasteride.
Finasteride or dutasteride, or they have other sort of issues. Minoxidil is a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor, and you have to make a choice in life, right? So 5-alpha reductase is the enzyme that makes dihydrotestosterone. So dihydrotestosterone is extremely important for the health of the smooth muscle cell of the penis, like really important. Whereas high dihydrotestosterone is really bad for the hair roots. So there are some people who not knowingly risking health to their penis will take finasteride. And it's not everybody, but it's a percentage. Even if it's just 2%, 5%, some small percent, it's an irreversible phenomenon. So if you create scar tissue in the penis, a la behind it, due to finasteride, which you take at age 18, 19, 16, whatever, to prevent baldness because your father is foe, that's a big problem.
I counsel my cases against it. Sometimes I have young men who want to take this, and I said, oh, I wouldn't do it. Because it's too risky, it's not worth it.
Well, it's not that everybody who takes it gets this, but boy, if you get this, you're in a long-term problem. So we have this strategy of using ultrasound. So the classic ultrasound in urology and sexual medicine is called the color duplex Doppler ultrasound. You can see the blood flowing. It's kind of really cool to see that. There's another aspect to ultrasound called grayscale ultrasound. And the picture behind me is showing that the healthy, potent male, if you ultrasound his penis, the tissue is all gray because, in essence, blood is going to every aspect of the spongy architecture of the penis. But now introduce excess scarring from a drug, either an SSRI or a 5-alpha reductase inhibitor, and you get regions where blood can't go because there's a ball of scar tissue, and you see on ultrasound a hypoechoic area versus a normoechoic. And the percentage of tissue that's hypoechoic is what we're finding to be the scar tissue. So these young men who have venous leakage are really individuals who on grayscale ultrasound will show high dense hypoechoic areas, and that scar tissue fails to achieve the trapping mechanism, and it's kind of awful. There's even more. We haven't even touched on this. There are people in Europe who ride bicycles, like 100 trillion people.
Mm-hmm.
And if you fall on the nail, the bicycle has this wonderful steel bar that I meant wonderful in a very sarcastic way. It's the most odd, stupid thing on earth. And if this is the bar and you slip and fall, you hit something, that will cause bleeding into that spongy architectural tissue in what's called the crus, the inside part of people. Most people don't even know they have a crus.
Mm-hmm.
But that will lead to this excess blue connective tissue in the crus, and it'll prevent in a focal region, like finasteride and 5-alpha reductase inhibitors of the whole penis. But selective regions of the penis showing scarring, they're all trauma.
Or I was thinking, like, maybe we're not diagnosing them right. So I have lots of young men who go around with this diagnosis of venous leakage based on color Doppler ultrasound. And one was very...
Color misses it.
Yes. Very careful to diagnose it this way. So sometimes I see... reports from other doctors, and I know this particular doctor.
Yeah, normal, go home,
yeah.
I want to, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's tonight doing the right study.
Maybe we're missing something here.
They need the grayscale. So the grayscale requires, see the usual person doing sexual medicine is cognizant of cost, and the ultrasound for color duplex can be with a less fancy ultrasound equipment. For grayscale, you need a very high-resolution probe. So we have a 15.4 megahertz probe. The classic ultrasound is like 8 megahertz. And it's typically for a pregnant woman, you put it on the outside of the distended abdomen, and the focus eventually gets to the uterus, and you can see the baby. But we have probes which are 1 millimeter from the site that we're interested in. You can't get away with unfancy equipment. Maybe that's the correct way to say it. Anyways, great scale ultrasound is really, really important. It's typically discussed in our literature as you do it before you do a color Doppler, the emphasis being on the color Doppler. And you see, it's a measure of cavernosal fibrosis. We understand that, but it has never been quantified. So we've made every effort to quantify the fibrosis. So we developed visual scales and all of that of the differences. And then we do shockwave. And then we reverse the fibrosis.
Is that what I was going to say? Because yeah. this is your picture, your poster, and you have demonstrated today that you can reverse corporeal fibrosis by shockwaves.
Yeah, that's not really much of a statement. I mean, to those in the field, Johannes Hohlfeld is a cardiac surgeon in Austria who does during coronary artery bypass graft with the beating heart straight in front of him. He puts shockwave directly on fibrotic cardiac tissue, which is in heart failure. Mm-hmm. And he can show you that the left ventricle after the shockwave contracts better and that there's less blood left at the end of the cardiac cycle. And in biopsies, he can show you that there's more muscle in the tissue of the heart than one would have anticipated based on the function. And there's a wonderful paper where you can study rat penis, spontaneously hypertensive rats that have sexual problems, spontaneous hypertensive rats, SHR rats, who have hypertension and the fibrosis of their erectile tissue, shockwaving those penises, you can take a sample, do a Masson's trichrome, and you'll see much more red. It's kind of well known in people who sort of do shockwave therapy. So for people with venous leakage, shockwave therapy should be a number one considerate.